Paris Center. Hop, recording, yes. A notion of barycenter in the space of priority measures and based on optimal weak mass transport. So first of all, I will introduce optimal transport in order for us to have the same words on what we are working with. And then I will talk about more specifically our work with Felipe Tobar and Joaquin Fombona that work at the CMM at the University of Chile in Santiago. Okay. So first of all, why are we interested in studying the averaging in the space of priority distributions? So in here you have images, and each of them you can see them as a probability measure. For that, it's really simple. Where you don't have any mass, you put zero. Where you have mass, you put one, and then you just normalize them in order to have a probability measure. So in here there is a grid, and each pixel represents is a support of our probability distribution. Okay, so when we consider these images as just images as we know, so just bit of zero and one, we can compare them, so we can average them with a classical Euclidean norm. So in this case, in here, for example, you have two images, a turtle and an arrow. And to go from this arrow to this turtle, you can average them using then the Euclidean norm, meaning that you're just looking for the mean between these two images with respect to the L2 norm. So depending on the weight that you're putting on this image and this image, you will have something that is more lookalike an arrow or more lookalike a turtle. But the goal in here, well, is just to put the images images on the same space and to just take some of the weight from the turtle and some of the weight from the arrow. And so this kind of average for images doesn't tell us a lot about the images that we are looking at the moment. And it's not very natural to go from this shape to this shape. Okay, so now if we consider an optimal transport mass metric in here, you will have that to go from this turtle to this turtle. So in here, we can think of geodesic, for example. So or more easily an interpolation, just an interpolation between images with respect to optimal transport. In here, you see that the turtle will be deformed in order to fit the arrow, okay? And so so that you can see it in every dimension, in every direction. So in here you have a circle and an arrow, and you can see that it is deformed in order to recover the support of the circle. And so obviously in here you have different weights with the four images, and you have a barycenter in each of these points. Okay. So with these images, I hope that I convinced you already that it can be interesting to look for barycenter in this space of Wasserstein, in this Wasserstein space. And for that, we have to consider then the images as probability measures. So now, a little bit of a definition of what is actually an optimal transport metric or Wasserstein metric. So originally, the problem was presented by Monge in the 18th century. So he asked himself how to transport a pile of sand onto a hole with a minimal effort. So in here, you have this. You can also understand it as you have a pile of sand, and you want to deform this pile of sand in order to fit this other pile of sand. Or if you want, if this was empty, to fit the hole of the with this shape. So in here, you have to think always that we are working with probability distribution. So both of these pile of sand are of measure one. Okay, so in here, what we are looking for is a map T, which will deform this probability measure mu into this probability measure nu. And for that to be well put, we have this operator, which is called the push forward operator, which take for each measurable set A, so in here you have this set, in here, in the support of the of mu. And for each of these sets, then the define as the set of support point of mu, such that the map T of X is going to this this support set in mu. So this set has to be equals. Okay. So this is a way to deform one probability measure into another one. And so, of course, now the Monge problem is to look into all of these maps defined as by this push forward operator, and to find the map that will minimize the cost of transporting the mass. In here, I put the Euclidean squared cost leading to the Wasserstein distance. So to be more precise, if we have two probability measures mu and nu with moments of order two, so this is just the classical assumption in order for this to be well defined. We are looking for a map T that will transport the map T that will transport the mass of mu into the mass of nu. Okay, and what does it mean to have this cost function in here? Is that to go from a point in here in A to go in the point in the support of nu in B, you will have to pay this distance, this Euclidean distance squared. Okay, so this is really the cost to move the mass along the along our space to the other measure. Okay, so this is crucial to have this push forward operator to define the Monge problem. However, such a map does not always exist. So in here, you have a really simple example where we have two probability measures that are discrete, meaning that mu is defined on this Dirac with mass one, and nu is defined on these two Diracs of mass one half and one half. Okay, so obviously such a map, which send x1 to y1 and y2 does not exist. In this case, such a Monge problem cannot be formulated that way, because this set of measurable function push forward is empty. Okay. Just a remark, of course, if we have we can have two distributions that are discrete, meaning supported on a finite number of points, such that such a map T exists. So in here, you have two choices for the map. Well, you have two choices for the map. Either you send x1 on y1 and x2 on y2. Either you can do the opposite, x1 on y2 and x2 on y1. And in this case, nu is indeed the push forward of nu by T. And the push forward is directly the push forward of a Dirac. Okay. Obviously, in this special case, the best T, meaning that the one that will minimize the Monge problem, will be the one with the straight lines, the vertical, the horizontal lines, because the cost to move this toward this is smaller than the one to move this toward this. Okay.
Which problem?
Sorry? Okay.
Did somebody want to ask a question? I mean, here you're assuming, of course, that those lines represent some sort of Euclidean distance.
Yeah, of course. I'm during all my talk, I will work on this Euclidean setting. Yeah. Yes. Right. And so just, okay. So now, how can we relax this this problem, this Monge problem? So this has been introduced by Kantorovich in the last century. And so with this problem, by introducing a transport plan with marginal mu and nu, we will have that we can allow mass splitting. In this case, the transport plan can infers the mass transportation from mu to nu in any case. Okay. An example now of this optimal transport plan. So this is a Kantorovich problem. So for example, if we have a discrete case, meaning that we have a measure mu that is supported on Dirac's with weights AI, and of course the sum of AI is equal to one. We have the same for nu, where we have a measure supporting on YJ with weight BJ. So in this case, the contour of each problem can be written as this linear programming. So in here, we have C, which is the cost matrix between the point XI and YJ. So in here, it's YJ. I made a mistake. And pi, which is the optimal transport map that we want to recover. So you have on the left an example of mu and nu supported on different points. So mu is supported on 3 points, x1, x2, x3, and nu on 4 points. And the idea is to find the best way, so the one that we minimize the cost of moving the mass, to go from mu to nu. So I'm just gonna do that. Okay. So in here, I have represented the transport plan, and in here, the transport plan directly. So in this, the discrete case, of course, the transport plan will be a matrix with size, the number of Dirac of each of our measures. So in here, you have x1, the weight of x1, which, and this will be distributed onto y2, y3, and y4. The weight of x2 will be distributed on y1 and y3. And so on. Okay, so if you want to watch it in this plot, you can see that, for example, x2, that it's here, will distribute onto y1 and y3. Why that? Because the closest of its point are in here, y1, which has less mass. So it sent a part of its mass in here and a part of its mass on y3. Okay, so of course this cannot be represented by the Monge problem, meaning that we need a map that push one measure onto another one. So in particular, if we have this setting of a continuous case, so meaning that we have two priority measures mu and nu, in this case, actually the the optimal map can be represented also as a transport plan in here, because actually the relationship between the Cantorich problem and the Monge problem is that is when we have, this is a sufficient condition, when you have that mu is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure, then the optimal Monge map and the optimal transport plan, so the optimal Monge map in the Monge problem and the optimal transport plan in the Cantorich problem, are related by this equality, meaning that actually the mass of P star is concentrated on the graph of a measurable function. Okay, so in this case, we will have that the Wasserstein 2 square distance. Well, the Wasserstein 2 distance is equal to the formulation of to the Cantorich problem and to the Monge problem. We have equivalence between the two problems. So quickly, why were we are interested in this case in particular, meaning the one we have a square distance as a cost function. In this case, actually, the Wasserstein distance, we can call it Wasserstein distance of or Cantorich problem or optimal transport. In this case, W2 defines a metric on the space of priority distributions with moments of order 2. So this is really interesting then to obtain some theoretical results in particular. Okay. So now that we have defined the Monge problem, the Cantorich problem, and that we have put into light the difference between a map, a Monge map, an optimal map, and optimal transport plan, I will present another way to see this this equality. So again, we are in the setting where mu is, okay, I'm gonna change a bit. mu is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. And we know actually that there will exist, there is unicity of the Monge map T star and of the transport plan P star, such that they are related as so, meaning that the optimal transport plan is supported on the graph of a measurable function. And actually, when we have this equation, this equality, we can see that T star is actually the integral of y against the disintegration of the transport plan P star. So disintegration with respect to the first marginal. So this transport plan, which is a measure with first marginal mu and second marginal mu, you can write it as a disintegration with respect to the first marginal mu. And when you integrate it against y, you will obtain the optimal Monge map. Okay, so now the really classical and really natural question to ask is, what if we want to use a map that will exist for any distributions? Because we saw that this map, a sufficient condition, is that mu is absolutely continuous. Now we want to work with any kind of distributions. So actually, this quantity, when we this quantity for any transport plan with marginal mu and nu, it can be defined. It can be defined as it, as a definition in here, and it is called a barycentric projection. So in here, barycentric has nothing to do with the barycenter. It's just that there is a notion of averaging. But I will go to the barycenter later. And so this barycentric projection, what it is, it's actually only a conditional expectation with this particular, where x and y have this particular low p nu mu nu. Okay, so this can be defined, of course, for any transport plan with marginal mu and nu. But this equality, again, of the optimal map and the optimal transport plan cannot exist always. Okay, so now, naturally, which plan should we choose in order to constrict some object and to constrict some barycenter after? This is the main point and the main reason that we have introduced the barycenter based on weak mass transport. So the answer is given by optimal weak transport problem. So in here, the optimal weak transport has been introduced by Gosselin, Roberto, Samson, and Tetali in 2017. And it is defined as like this. So in here, you will search for, you will look for the optimal, unoptimal transport plan, P with marginal mu and nu, such that the distance from X, the point of the support of mu, and the barycentric projection between, constructed from mu and nu is minimized. Okay, and this you can write it also in terms of random variables, where you are looking for an optimal couple, such that this quantity is minimized. Okay, so now why is it interesting to see to study such quantity? First of all, the optimal plan in the weak sense is unique for any distribution, which is not the case in the classical optimal transport. Okay, and why it's not the case? We had the example with the two discrete measure, where we saw that we have two way to distribute the mass. And if you can imagine other examples where you can distribute either in this way, the mass between two discrete measures. Okay.
So what are you giving up here with a weak transport? Oh, sorry. I was just saying, what are you giving up with weak transport to get back this idea of uniqueness? Because the idea that you have several optimal plans makes a certain amount of sense intuitively. What are you giving up here to get uniqueness back?
Well, first of all, the problem is not written in the same way at all. I mean that you have this characterization, for example, which can be more intuitive than the definition. So the optimal weak mass transport from mu to nu, because it's not symmetric, of course, you can write it actually in terms of the classical Wasserstein distance squared. But it is but that this way you are looking for a measure eta, which is smaller in convex order than nu. Okay, that minimize this quantity. So these two are equals when actually there is no probability distribution that are smaller than nu. So I'm not sure that is more smaller in convex order. So what is the convex ordering of measure, first of all, maybe, is that if you have any convex function phi, eta is smaller than nu if the integral of phi against eta is smaller than the integral of phi against nu. Okay. So to be a little bit more precise or to give more intuition, let this relation implies that eta and nu must have the same expectation. Okay. So,
okay.
Yeah, and another fact is that if we take just the squared function, you will have that eta must have a variance smaller than nu. Okay, so in this case, you can see that you are looking for a measure that will be close to mu, but which is smaller or more concentrated in some sense than the measure of the original target measure nu. Okay, so you have more flexibility in that sense. Okay, so in here, in this problem, you will have a uniqueness. I'm not sure it was.
No, that helpful. Thank you.
Okay.
I see a little bit.
Okay. Okay, so this is to give some color of this problem. And in this case, when you have this optimal eta, actually it can be written as a push-forward measure with respect to this barycentric projection that we have constructed from the optimal plan in the weak sense. Okay, so this writing for the classical optimal transport problem does not exist every time. So this is the Monge problem. It will be the Monge problem, but in here we have a formulation which exists for any kind of distribution with the right amount of moments, of course, the right moments. Okay, and so the last remark was what I explained about the variance of our measure defined by the convex ordering. Okay. An example maybe to be more clear about the difference between the classical optimal transport and the one in the weak sense. So in here we have represented two probability measures, mu and nu, discrete ones. And so we have red crosses for the mu and blue crosses for nu. If we compute the barycentric projection, which is always defined as the integral of y against the disintegration, which is still a conditional expectation, and that can be written in the discrete sense, since P in this case is a matrix, y is the support of nu, the point of the support of nu, and A is the weight of nu. Okay. So in this case, since there is not a map, since there is not an optimal Monge map between mu and nu, when we are computing S OT of X, this map will not be equal to the Monge map, which is not exist. But we still can construct the barycentric projection with respect to the optimal plane in the OT sense. One remark, if the optimal map existed, then all of these dots, the arranged dots that represent the push forward of mu against this map, would arrive directly on nu. Because this is the definition of the Monge problem. We want to look for a map that push mu onto nu. Okay. So in this case, the arranged dot tries to approach the nu distribution, but cannot be equal to the distribution nu. Okay. If you construct now a barycentric projection with respect to an optimal plane in the OT, in the weak transport sense. In this case, you will have the green dots. And what are the green dots trying to do? I'm just putting in here. So in here, the green dots are represented as are the best eta, which is this object. Okay, so the green map is smaller than nu in the convex ordering sense, but still closer than mu than than any other distribution that will be smaller than nu. Okay, so now what does it mean is that the green dots are smaller in the convex ordering sense than the blue crosses, but they give the smaller classical distance, the certain distance, to the red crosses, which is mu. And you can see that the green dots are more concentrated than the original measure nu, the blue crosses. Okay, I hope that this helps. This is another example in one dimension. And so in here, you can see that the measures that we are constructing, which is in the idea smaller in convex order than nu, and still closer to mu than nu in the classical optimal transport sense. Okay. So now let's talk about a little bit about barycenters, which was the principal, the main subject of this presentation. So in here, we come back to the classical definition, so the classical Wasserstein metric. So a barycenter is defined as for a set of priority measure, nu1, nuk, with weight lambda one, lambda k, such that the sum of these weights is equal to one, and each of these weights are positive. So in this case, we are looking for a measure mu, which will minimize the distance, the square distance, pondered by the lambda e, to each of the measure of our set. Okay. So in here, it's a really classical definition also. It is called the Frechemin with respect to the Wasserstein two distance. And if you replace, for example, the Wasserstein 2 distance by Nell 2 distance, you will obtain the classical definition of a mean that we all know. A mean, for example, of functions. In this case, Alvarez Esteban, his co-author, and Zemel El-Panaretos also, have demonstrated that if we take all of our set of priority measure absolutely continuous, with at least one of them with bounded density, we will have that the unique barycenter verifies a fixed point equation. Okay, and so this fixed point equation is written in terms of the Monge map. The Monge map, I recall, it's the Monge map is defined in the Monge problem, such that between mu bar and nu I, and such that the push forward of nu bar against this such a map T will end up on nu I. Okay, but for that Monge map to exist, we will need at least one sufficient condition is that the measure is absolutely continuous. okay, for the existence of such a map and such a push forward equality. And from this fixed point characterization, they propose an iterative procedure in order to compute a fixed point through the, I have to move this. Okay. Sorry. Yeah, so an iterative procedure through the Monge optimal map. Okay, so this was the inspiration for our work also, and we wanted to change this such a map T, which does not always exist, by the barycentric projection. And the idea was to use the optimal weak mass transport in order to have a proper problem well defined. So in this case, we defined the barycenter optimal weak transport problem, such as in the classical sense, but we replaced the Wasserstein 2 distance squared by the optimal weak mass transport from mu to nu 1. Okay, so in this case, we will have that the weak barycenter admits solutions. And in a very natural, just so to fix the ideas, so in here, we had the classical Wasserstein barycenter problem with a Monge map. And what we did is that we replaced by the optimal weak mass transport problem. And in here appears the barycentric projection with respect to the best transport plan in the weak optimal sense. Okay. Some intuition of about this weak barycenter. So first of all, the weak barycenter is not unique. Okay, and in particular, we have that a Dirac distribution located in the mean of the expectation of our measure is also a weak barycenter, and it's the only one as a Dirac distribution. Okay, so you have all of your measure, all of them have a mean, an expectation. And if you look at the pondered mean of this expectation, you will obtain a weak barycenter. The Dirac on this point is a weak barycenter. Okay. Another point is that if we have that all of our measures have the same mean, so we can translate them in the same mean, then a weak barycenter, we have an if and only if condition on the barycenter is that if the measure is smaller in the convex order than all of the measure in our set, the set of the barycenter, you know that this is also a weak barycenter. Okay, and for Gaussian distribution, this implies that actually the set of Gaussian measure with the same mean and with variance which is smaller than all of the variants of our data set, of the measure of the data set, you will have that this set is also a set of weak barycenter. Okay, so you have a lot of information. And to finish with some remarks and intuitions, so you, if you have, you can actually compare a classical Wasserstein barycenter with a barycenter in the weak sense by taking, for example, priority measure nu1 nu k that are absolutely continuous with one of them at least with bounded density, and then we can compare so the Wasserstein barycenter with any of the weak barycenters, and you will have that it is actually controlled by the variance of the measure in your data set. So of course, if the variance is smaller, smaller, and smaller, you will have that the barycenters are equal and equal to the Dirac. Okay. So now some interpretation of this result, this weak barycenter, in terms of a latent variable model. So in here, you can consider mu a weak barycenter with the random variable x following mu, and y high random variables also following the measure of nu I. Which and mu is not a direct measure. Okay, so in this case, actually, each nu I can be written as a weak barycenter plus a translation term plus a cluster-specific component, meaning that this this term always only depends on the Meson UI and the Weakberry Center. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that actually a Weakberry Center can be seen as a latent variable. And why is it interesting to see the Weakberry Center in this interpretation? Is that in this case, we can see it as a robustness to outlier result. I explained myself. So in here, you have that a Weakberry Center, a measure is a Weakberry Center plus a translation term. Okay, so this is plus some noise. You can see the cluster-specific component has some noise intrinsic in the components. So in here, I have represented two data sets, actually. So one data set is correspond to 15 Gaussian distribution and 15 Gaussian distribution with random observation for each of them. Okay. And I then took the same data set and I have corrupted 5% of the observations, corrupted by translation. Okay, so we have one data set and one corrupted data set. So on the right, I have represented four Barry Center. So in red, we have the classical optimal transport Barry Center. I don't know if it's can really see something, but okay, so the dots represent the barycenter of the corrupted data set, and the crosses represent the barycenter of the non-corrupted data set. So you can see that we have outlier in here due to the corruption of some of the observation of the data set. Okay, and optimal transport is the classical optimal transport is actually known to be to not be robust to outlier, to be sensible to this kind of observations. Whereas when we are looking for the weak barycenter, meaning the barycenter with respect to the weak mass transport, in this case, you will have that both barycenter from the data set and from the corrupted data set behave similarly, have the same, more or less the same support. Okay. So now some computation part. So in here we have developed in the same ways in the classical sense, the same ways as Alvarez, Esteban, and Scota, a fixed point approach for the weak barycenter plurin. So in here we define G mu as a push forward of mu against the sum, the weighted sum of the barycentric projection, with this barycentric projection optimal in the weak sense, meaning that to recall the definition before, so meaning that we are looking for pi with marginal mu and nu I, which achieve the minimum in the optimal weak mass transport. Then we compute the barycentric projection, which is just the conditional expectation, and we define g mu from this map. Okay, and we can also define a sequence of a fixed point. And in this case, we'll have that if mu is a weak barycenter, then mu is a fixed point of this equation, of this function, sorry. Okay, and then when we are working with the, when we are working with this sequence defined as mu n plus 1 is equal to g of mu n, iterating like that, we'll have that every converging subsequence of mu n will converge towards a fixed point of g. Okay. So, of course, assuming that mu is a fixed point doesn't imply that mu is a weak barycenter. And we would have liked that. Actually, we have the equivalence, but this is not that trivial. In particular, even in the classical Wasserstein barycenter framework, so with absolutely continuous, with absolutely continuity of the measures and with the bounded density of one of them. The being a fixed point, a fixed point does not imply that you are a barycenter in the clear in the without without adding any assumption. So this is true when we have the equality for x for every x in RD and not only mu almost everywhere. Another condition is by invoking more smoothness on the distribution, and with this additional smoothness condition, you will obtain the inverse implication. Okay. But since in our case, we were interested in particular to given up some of the smoothness condition on the distribution, we are not expecting to have a similar result at all. Okay. Now another scenario. In here, we are interesting to also construct weak barycenter, but when we receive new observation along the way, meaning that we are receiving, what is a new observation in this case? A new observation is a new priority measure. So we are constructing the weak barycenter for a fixed number of points of measure, and we have new measure along the way, okay? And in this case, to deal with this framework, we need to work with priority measure in the space of priority measure. What do I mean by that? We consider Q, which is a priority distribution measure, supported on a set of priority measure. Okay. And in this case, we can define the weak population barycenter, which is still written in the same way as before, just that we have an integral. If Q is a discrete distribution, meaning supported on a finite number of measure, we will recover the classical weak barycenter problem. In this case, we are looking for a measure mu that minimizes the integral of the optimal weak mass transport against the measure Q. Okay, so this problem also admits solution. And in the classical Wasserstein setting, this has been introduced by Logwick and Lubes, and also Alvarez and Esteban and co-author. Okay. So in this case, you will obtain a really, we obtain really, really similar result than in the discrete case, except it is in the larger framework of priority measure supported on priority measure. So in this case, we have that if mu is a barycenter of Q, then we will have this equality, mu almost everywhere. Okay. And we will develop, the idea is also to develop an iterative algorithm to compute a weak barycenter with new data along the way. Okay. So for that, we will need a technical assumption actually on Q, an additional assumption, which is that Q must give full measure to this compact set, which is a set of measure with moments of order 2, such that their moment of order 2 plus epsilon is also is bounded. Okay. So why do we need this assumption on Q? It's actually in order I will present first of all this sequence. So in here, we define mu k plus one, which is the push forward of mu k, so sequence, to the measure defined as one minus lambda k identity plus gamma k identity plus gamma k and the barycentric projection, where mu k is sampled from Q. Okay. And so this assumption on this assumption A is needed in order for this sequence to stay in some compact, in order to control the convergence. Okay, so it's really this can be generalized by just saying that we want this push forward for a mu k which belongs to some compact set k we want that mu case push forward this this function stays in the compact K. Okay, so this assumption A is just sufficient in order to have this fact. Okay, so now we have another another iterative algorithm. So we, if you assume the condition on Q, and that in this case every measure verifying the fixed point equation is a weak barycenter, then we will have that the sequence mu k will that every subsequence of mu k will converge to a weak barycenter. Okay, so in this case we have an additional assumption of fixed point implies weak barycenter. Also, we need more control on our seconds. I won't go into the details, but I will go maybe just to the, some maybe that can interest some of you, the computational part of this work. So yes, so the computational part. In here, we have to, if you want to compute the sequence to compute a fixed point, so you have to compute actually this push forward. This push forward, what is hard to compute is to obtain the barycentric projection, which is more or less a solution of your optimal weak mass transport. Okay, so to go to solve this problem, we're actually solving it in the discrete case. So we consider that either we have observation of our measures, either that we are working directly with a discrete measure. So our measure mu and nu are defined in here. Mu is supported on x, y, and nu on y, j. And actually, as I presented before, the barycentric projection, as it is conditional expectation, just can be computed by the multiplication of matrices. Okay, so in here we have pi, which is the solution of this problem, and then the support points of mu and the weights, the support point of nu and the weights of mu. Okay, so when we have the transport plan pi, constructing again the barycentric projection is direct. Okay, so just a little remark on the martingale optimal transport problem that maybe some of you know, and it's really close to the optimal weak mass transport. The difference is that in the optimal martingale transport problem, you will look for a transport plan with marginal mu and nu, but for measures that are already in convex order. So this is just a remark for those of you who knows martingale optimal transport problem. So it's not the same problem, but it's really, really, it's closely related. Okay. So now how to compute the barycentric projection, the optimal barycentric projection in the weak sense. In here, I have written it in terms of quadratic programming. In this case, you can use a solver to solve a quadratic programming problem with this condition. So this is a condition P1 is equal to mu, is just a condition on the marginals in order for the marginal of P being mu and nu, okay? In the transport plan, so we need the weights that are greater than one, than zero. Okay, and then, okay, so in here it's not mu and nu, it's A and B. Sorry for that. Another way to compute the optimal transport plan in the weak sense is to use actually a proximal algorithm where we will have the first part being the cost function, that you try to minimize, and the second part being the space of constraints of pi, which is defined as an indicator function of the set pi mu nu, which is a set of priority measure with marginal mu and Okay, so in this case, you can use, I'm not going into the detailizer, but you can just use the proximal operator to have convergence of the VS Fista algorithm to have convergence of the algorithm to obtain the optimal transport plan. Okay, and then once you have the optimal transport plan in the weak sense, you can construct again the barycentric projection with respect to this transport plan, and you can use this sequence to construct a fixed point of your problem. Just to compare our results with classical settings, so we will compare them to the classical setting of optimal transport plan. And I call it OT barycenter like this because actually, so we will use this sequence to construct optimal transport barycenter, but we will use instead of the optimal transport plan in here, in the weak sense, we will use an optimal transport plan in the classical W2 sense. Okay, and it's not really constructing a barycenter because this barycentric projection constructed from some transport plan, even it is if it is optimal in the counter-reach problem, will not construct an optimal Monge map. Okay, and we also construct the same sequence with the optimal transport plan, which solves this problem, entropy regularized optimal transport problem. So this I presented it because it's widely used in the optimal transport community, because by adding this this entropy term, this Kullback-Leibler term, you can use an algorithm that is called Sinkhorn algorithm, which will allow you to greatly increase the decrease the computational time to obtain an optimal transport plan. So this one is really the classical setting that are for which the experiments are done in the community. Okay, so in all of this, I recall that we are working with discrete distribution. So in here, I have presented the point cloud of 15 Gaussian distribution. So point clouds of our observation of Gaussian distributions. And I have presented the classical OT barycenter, the OT barycenter for the optimal transport regularized by entropy, and the weak barycenter. So in red, you have the red and the black dots are the same for the three plots. The blue dots represent the OT, the Sinkhorn barycenter with the regularization parameter epsilon in here increasing. Okay, so what we can see is that the weak barycenter, which is represented in black, is more concentrated than the classical OT barycenter. And by increasing the regularization parameter epsilon, we can see that we are coming closely to the weak barycenter, and then the Sinkhorn barycenter, is concentrated and more concentrated in a Dirac, converging toward the Dirac. And this is really easy to understand, actually, because as the regularization parameter increases, so we increase the amount of entropy, and we will obtain actually a transport plan that will be almost uniform in all of this support. And when then we compute the barycentric projection, which is still a conditional expectation, you will have that all of the sum over the row, you can see like that for the matrix, will end up on the same point. Okay. So this is just an intuition between this concentration of Dirac's.
And can you say something about the variance of the weak barycenter compared to the variance of the optimal transport barycenter in general? Can you order them?
So we can say that since we can it is possible to understand, well, in easy cases, to understand the barycenter, the classical barycenter, with respect to the variance of each of the, for measures that are centered, in respect to the variance of each of the measures, for example. Okay, for example, in the Gaussian case, classical Gaussian case, and the measures are centered, the barycenter, the classical one, will have the mean. Its variance will be the mean of the variance of the standard deviation of all of the measures. Okay. And the variance of the weak barycenter will be smaller than all of the variances of the measure. So you still have this idea of concentration, which, sorry, yes.
So is this a general property that the variance of the weak barycenter is always less than the variance, or no more than the variance of the standard barycenter?
No, it's not. This I observed it, but I haven't proved it, and I haven't managed to prove it.
But it may be true. You don't know, or you're not sure.
No. I'm not. I don't know.
Thank you.
I observed it, but if you ask for my opinion, I think it's true. But,
thanks.
Okay, and then one last example. It's just to recall the idea of latent variable model. So in here we have spiral distribution, meaning that we have distributions that are supported on spirals. We have 10 distributions, and we are computing still the optimal transport barycenter and the weak barycenter. So the optimal transport barycenter, it will lose a little bit the shape of the spiral. Against the weak barycenter will stay more concentrated on the spiral. And this is because you can interpret it also as the in the sense of the latent variable model, is that the weak barycenter will merge the geometrical information of the measures that you have at the end. And the weak barycenter will present the common geometrical information shared by all the measures. So this is the intuitive difference between the OT barycenter and the weak barycenter. Okay. Okay, so some idea for the future, let's say. So in here, I've presented this work, and I've said at some point that a direct distribution is a weak barycenter. There is one direct distribution that is a weak barycenter. So obviously, this kind of barycenter is not interesting. And so when we are computing a weak barycenter, we would like to ensure that we are not getting the direct masses at the weak barycenter, because it does not tell a lot about our data set. Another direction that we would like to explore is that there is a notion of maximal measure in terms of convex ordering in dimension one. So if we have a set of weak barycenter, there is in dimension one a maximal one. Okay, but in dimension two, it's more complicated to understand. So in this, we would like to understand what does it mean to be maximal in dimension two, or further. Okay, and in here there is some bibliography if you're interested in these topics, and in particular in optimal weak mass transport, I will recommend you these two papers. If you want to just have a look and understand what are the general concept of it. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Elsa. Sorry, I'm having trouble with my cursor. Do people have questions maybe on the applications of this stuff? How do you see, this stuff working on, what is it helping you explain your data? So a very general, naive question, but maybe you can take it from there, because I'm very interested in the transport models, but from a very different point of view. And you obviously are interested in how it tells you stuff about your data. But so, what can you do with this stuff with your data that you can't do otherwise?
Okay, so I have an example that I really like. that I work on like a few years ago. It was just so the data set were names, actually, the repartition of names in the 20th century in France. So each histogram represented the number of births with a given name. So with Pierre, with Marie, with Jérémy, such like that. And okay, so we made them priority distribution by normalizing them. But we are, you have an idea of how is it put along the century, if you want. So for example, Pierre is really uniform. So from 1912 and 1982, there is more or less the same number of Pierre in France, of proportionally to the population. Okay, and so when you do when you look at the Barry Center for this kind of data set, when you look it in terms of L2 distance, for example, you will have such just a quantitative result about the repartition of the births in the 20th century in France. Okay, so we'll have just okay, there are this many births in 1982 and this many births in 1942. Okay, but if you do Barry Center in the OT sense, so in the Wasserstein sense, you will have something that looks more or less like Gaussian. Okay, and this, what does it tell you? It tells you that, and this I saw it in different histograms, but this tells you that actually there is an effect trending effect, if you want, that a name, when it's given at some time t, it will given the year before and the year after. You know, there is this trending effect when you give a name at a child. So you will recover this kind of Gaussian aspect of your data set with the Wasserstein Barry Center. So this is really practical. I'm not sure it was your question, but this can be an application of this kind of Barry Centers for social study, for example.
Okay. No, thank you. Other questions or remarks?
So perhaps I had a question, but that is of numerical aspects. So I know that people love the SYNCHRON-SELECT algorithm because it's easy to implement and its convergence is pretty nice. But can you say something about like the convergent aspect of these fixed point select methods for OWT? So does it converge quickly? I mean, what are the limitations? Because for example, SYNCHRON is pretty nice for, let's say, distribution for a few thousand points, and but this one, so how far, so can you use it? So that does it converge well, quickly, and for how many points?
It's very bad.
Okay.
Yeah. To be completely honest, it's very bad. Why that? It's because to compute only one optimal transport plan in the weak sense, you will have to either solve the quadratic programming, either the proximal algorithm problem, okay?
Yes,
so in the quadratic programming, of course, when you have a lot of points, it won't work. Mm-hmm. And in the proximal algorithm, you will have to converge already to make this algorithm converges. And this can take a lot of time because you have a gradient descent, and depending on the step that you choose, gamma k, and all of this problem of this classical problem in optimization, let's say.
But can't you do exactly like so SYNCHRON is to optimal transport, so a regularized version, but isn't there a regularized version of this so that can go like much faster?
Well, you can see this problem actually as a SYNCHRON problem. With a regularization that is a Frobenius norm, that with a Frobenius norm as a regularization, but still you have to compute a weak Barry Center, you will have several loops. Well, before that, you will have loops in your problem to compute an optimal transport plan, and you have to compute it. So in here, it's for the online algorithm, but for, let's say, for this problem, if you have many measure, you will have to compute k sub problems to then compute one step of your iterative procedure. Mm. And this has to converge also. So no, I won't say that. I will not say that it's really. Okay. It's not practical. Let's say. I hope it will be better at some point, but for now.
And you have hope of finding better methods?
Yeah, I do. With people that know better than me in optimization, maybe.
Great.
So, great. If you have ideas, Reda, I'm ready to hear them. Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, Reda. Anybody else? Okay. Well, Elsa, thank you again, and I wish you all a happy weekend. And have a good weekend. Thanks a lot, Elsa, again.
Thank you. Have a nice weekend.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Ugh.